So I'm Matilla, and I'm one of the engineering directors at Schibsted. And today I'm going to talk about natural language processing and image processing at Schibsted. So I want to give you just a very brief highlight on Schibsted if you don't know which company it is, but then give you just a few examples of some of the projects that we're working on and leave some time for questions. But feel free to jump in anytime. Schibsted is a company that was founded about 178 years ago, and it's present in 30 countries. We're about over 7,000 employees, and we have 200 million unique users that generate about 20 billion page previews a month. This company has gone through a lot of transformations, and it is going through a transformation now. Even if you don't recognize Schibsted, you probably recognize some of these brands on the screen. And these are all Schibsted companies. Strategically, they're divided into media houses, marketplaces, and growth companies. There has been a transformation effort about 3 years ago. And what happened there is that we tried to coordinate and organize technical work and product work so that we avoid duplication of efforts and we make use of technical initiatives by each other. So this global product and tech group was initiated and focused on enabling technologies, components, and platforms. This is where we are, the NLP and image groups within the data and analytics group of the Schibsted products and technology. And this has been a great experience that I'm going to talk to you about in a little bit. But there is one more reorganization that is happening as we speak. So the NLP and image teams would be organized in a different constellation, but the work will continue. So these groups that I'm going to talk about are organized under a team called Cognition, and there are three teams that collaborate in this group. It's a data platform team, a natural language processing team, and an image processing team. These are very small teams that we kickstarted in the spring of 2016, and we started from scratch, meaning we're hiring and building the products that we have in production now as we go along. I'm not going to talk about the data platform team that much, but this is the team that is responsible for ingesting all the events that are being pushed into the central organization and making sure that we have a compliant data storage and a very easily discoverable data store and dissemination of the data with the right access. The platform briefly looks like this. There is a data collector that collects about over 800 million events per day, which is about 2 TB of data. And we have data stores and various consumers that get that data through streaming or through batch processing. And the advantage of having this data collector and data storage centrally is that it allows us to do things like de-identification or GDPR compliance in one place and avoid duplication of efforts over the companies. So, going to the image services, I'm going to talk about two of the core projects that we have been working on. One is an ad classifier, and the other is a similarity search or a similarity-based recommender. For the ad classifier, for any given image URL, we focus on the images primarily. Given an image URL, our service produces the most probable categories. So it's a list of categories with a probability from high ranking to low ranking. And this is used in production by our Rocket Markets. Rocket is the second generation marketplace app that Schibsted is working on. And this app is an effort towards converging the platforms that the different marketplaces that Schibsted has are using. And it's live in production in five marketplaces, and there is a sixth one in testing. And what I will show you a very small clip later. And this is based on convolutional neural networks and the internal Shipstead data to train on. Currently, we have a new model in testing, and this model combines the features from the images as well as the features from the title. And this is giving us a really good boost in performance. So we extract the features, concatenate, and then do the predictions. When it comes to the similarity search, the technology underneath is practically similar. You have to train the models for classification, but then you can extract the last layer of the convolutional neural net and use that as a feature set to find similar items. But there is quite a lot of work that goes into indexing and finding similar items within a very, very, very large space. So we have designed good ways to kind of hash and index so that we find similar items very, very quickly and can produce this in real time. And we're also testing using not only the image features, but also the text, primarily the title of the ad, to be able to provide the similar images. Another thing that we're working on is being able to identify inappropriate content by looking at the image, and we're going to add the text as well, and to detect image quality. In the marketplaces, people will take pictures and then they would upload it. Based on how good the image is, we've seen correlations on the ability to sell the item. So we have models that we're experimenting with to identify if an image is of good quality, that is, if it's too dark or blurry and such. So, hope this works. Yeah. This is the auto categorization project. So when you insert an ad, you can take a picture of your ad, and then our app automatically suggests, so you have to give the title, and then you get an automatic suggestion of what the category of this particular item you're trying to sell should be. And here it identifies it as cell phones and gadgets, which goes into electronics. And this is for ease of use for the sellers, because they would be able to upload their ads very quickly, but also it allows us to allow buyers to find the things that they're looking for quickly and efficiently, because most people search by looking at the different categories and subcategories and try to find things there. And for a similar ad, so what we're looking at here is that someone is looking at backpacks, and when they click on the backpack, there is a rolling band of other backpacks that are on sale in that particular marketplace that would be shown. And if you keep on clicking on the rolling band, then whatever you clicked on becomes the primary image, and we show other similar products that are similar to the one that you just clicked on. And by doing that, what we're doing is helping the users kind of zoom in on what they're looking for. Especially in the fashion category, it's kind of hard to describe the things that you're looking for, and you might be able to find it by clicking through and zooming in your search. One thing to note here is that we can add a newly added ad or a newly posted ad within a second of its addition to the recommendation engine, which I think is a pretty cool way of, that's how fast our system works. Another thing, this is very fast. You get a response within 100 milliseconds. So the user experience is very good, so that whenever they're clicking, they get more and more images into their feed. Those are the highlights from the image team. When it comes to the natural language processing team, we started with building components. Whenever you deal with text and apply different natural language processing applications, you need to use, or for the most at least, a few components, basic building blocks that are always recurring. So when we kickstarted these teams, we knew that we would have to deal with this over and over again. So where we started is by identifying the components that are very important and started building those components. I will give examples of each of these components. So what we did is added a tokenizer that finds the boundary for words, a sentence splitter that finds the boundary for sentences, a stammer that kind of reduces words to one common form. Cars becomes car so that you don't count it twice or miss something because it's represented slightly differently or it's a different form of the word. Part of speech tagger that assigns the part of speeches for the word. So here drawn is a proper noun and boat is a verb, etc. And a noun phrase chunker that finds noun phrases. In this example, John, car, and Tesla Roadster are the noun phrases that we find. Before I get into topic models, what we did with this components is that we used a lot of open source data set and a lot of open source tools that we found. And we just built a thin wrapper around it and we created a pipeline so that you can just push in a text and then you get a decent annotation out on the other end. That works well for us. One thing that we try to do is that we would like to contribute back to the open source community as much as we can. So we have, for example, a Greek stammer, which we couldn't find something we wanted or that was good for the use case we had. So we wrote one and pushed it back to the Snowball stammers. Another thing that we're currently doing is we are trying to create a good named entity recognizer for Norwegian. And we couldn't find any named entity tagged data set. So we're collaborating with the Norwegian National Library. And we have a project that's funded by the National Library and Schibsted, and we're tagging named entities for Norwegian, and that would be an open source data set that would be released. Of course, we're gonna do our recognizer in Schibsted, but also give back to the community where we use quite a lot from. When it comes to topic models, these are a way to represent documents as a mixture of topics instead of just the words that they contain. And if you look at this example, going back, of course, we use the pipeline to do all the pre-processing that we need to do. And for the topic model that we are using, we use only noun phrases, for example, because it allows the models to converge fast and it avoids a lot of noise without losing so much information. So the concept is that the documents are represented as a mixture of topics and each word would contribute towards the topic. If you look here, the word Roadster and Tesla contribute towards the topic electric cars, and the word Tesla, the words Tesla and Edison contribute towards the topic electricity. Of course, all words contribute towards topics, but the degree of contribution differs. And we use this, I will give examples of what we use these components for NLP. We're also building some framework that makes it easy for us to train or to create word and document embeddings from various types of documents. And we are using this to generate, for example, keywords when people are looking for jobs. We suggest different keywords based on word embeddings, and we use document embeddings to find similar text. It's for news articles and matching jobs and candidates, etc. So some of the services that we have from NLP in the different groups of Schibsted, we have a message intent labeling service in marketplaces and a keyword suggestion and matching jobs to candidates for marketplaces. For one of the growth companies, we have an automatic categorization in collaboration with Preciact. and a few applications in the media organizations about true publishing, tax suggestion, etc. So quickly going through these. Most of our marketplace and other apps use messaging between our customers, and understanding the intent of that message allows us to help the users communicate with each other more efficiently, and we can build products on top of the recognized message intents. For example, if an item is sold in a marketplace and we know that from the message that we see the item is already sold, if the person is getting 50 more requests asking, is this item sold, then we don't have, the person doesn't have to reply that I've sold it multiple times, or just ignore the requests, and the user experience from the buyer side wouldn't be as good. So what we can do would be to just ask them, is this item sold? If they say yes, you can broadcast to all the requesters. There are many things that we can add here. If the communication is about should we meet, then you could suggest a location or show them a map, etc. There's quite a lot that can be done by using the intent of the messages. And we started with one of the marketplaces in Spain, so this example is in Spanish. And we've identified, in collaboration with the product people, the different intents of the messages, and the result that you get would be a probability of what the intent of the message is. For training this model, we used our topic model to start with because we didn't have any label data. We generated some topics, and then we, in an unsupervised way or semi-supervised way, generated data to train on. But then, in order to improve the performance, we are planning to manually tag the intent of messages. But this wouldn't be data that we would be sharing. I mentioned one of the growth companies earlier. This is an example from working with Prisjakt. If you know what Prisjakt does, they compare prices. But to be able to compare prices, they have to map all sorts of different names and categories that they get from the e-stores into their own internal product names and categories. So we collaborated with them, and we've managed to automate 60% of the manual work when it comes to the category mapping. And this is not particularly very NLP, but yeah, using text. And it's done by the NLP team. One of the projects that we have in collaboration with a media house, a Schibsted media house in Norway, is the ability to republish articles. So some articles are very current and you show them today and that's that, but some articles can be shown multiple times. They are evergreen and you can republish them. So what we did in collaboration with them was build a topic model using 6 years of data. And they say that their topics are very static. So we know which topics are in, which articles belong to which topic. So this has given the newsroom a very granular view of which are the articles that belong to which topic and which topics sell the most, for example, or sell at what time of the day, etc. And they see when the topic or the article has been published and which articles are generating sort of the most clicks and the most engagement from the users in terms of buying to read those articles, etc. And they could determine when to republish an article. So this is more generating an insight for the publishers and journalists. Another application that uses our NLP system is tag suggestions. So whenever the journalists write articles, they generate, or they manually have to tag the articles about what topic it is. And what we're doing is suggest tags for the journalists looking at the text that they've written, and then they could click on the tag that is more appropriate. So this is a suggestion from the machine learning part, but there is a manual human in the loop, where the final decision is done by the journalists and editors. So the tag suggestions, again, are a probability. And the newsroom itself would decide which tags to show based on a cutoff probability, and that they have full control over. Another project that uses one of the NLP topic models is a personalized content generation. So the topics show you which articles are related to each other, or which articles are conceptually and contextually similar to each other. So by using that, you could show if I'm reading about the current market about the apartments and how it's selling. So all articles that are within that category could be shown to me because I've shown interest in that. We have two ways of finding recommendation articles for our users. One is collaborative filtering, where you see the usage patterns of people. So if two people are looking at similar articles without really looking into the content, you could see that if person A is looking at articles 1 to 10 and person B is also looking at articles 1 to 8, then article 9 and 10 might be relevant for the person A. And the other is looking at a person has viewed article A, then that means if there are articles that are of the same topic as article A, then those might be relevant to the user. So this is work in progress that we're going to release very shortly. And we have a bunch of hackathons and experiments in collaboration with various companies within Schibsted. And what we try to do with these hackathons and experimentations is that we do some form of ideation. We get people from product, tech, engineering, data science, and UX, put them in one room for a couple of days and hack away, so that we come up with ideas and see where the data is, how we get access to it, and then come up with different ideas to explore further. And some of these ideas become projects on their own. Some of them are just fun things we've done and we shelf them. So this is just a quick example of the kind of projects that we do, so that we come up with different ideas. And yeah, it's a bunch of image, a hackathon result from an image and media hackathon. And the first one on that far end shows a person looking for a police car. They might be able to find all other police car pictures within the archive, so that they don't have to go out and take that picture or go out and buy a picture from somebody else. And object detection, sentiment analysis, etc. And these are projects that are probably something that we're going to work on down the line, but nothing in production, just hackathon results. So the kind of things that we have in the pipeline and that we're working on, in the similarity search we looked at earlier, we have only models only for the fashion category. We want to add more categories to that project, mainly furnitures and antiques, etc., that are kind of hard to describe. We're going to add more marketplaces. We have, as I mentioned, 6 right now, but we're going to expand to more marketplaces. We have a global model that is trained on data not only from one particular marketplace, because currently we have one model per marketplace. We're working on a global model that trains on data from multiple marketplaces, so that if there are companies with very small data set, especially for the smaller marketplaces, then we could use the universal or the global model as a base and then fine tune with their own data. The similarity search or the similarity service can also be used to suggest prices during ad insertion. We don't really have to do anything other than put the cutoff point very, very high. So if if someone is selling some product for a certain amount of price, then if I'm selling and I'm not sure how much I should ask for it, it might give me an idea by looking at the most similar ads within that marketplace. But as I mentioned, it has to be very, very accurate to suggest those prices. We're going to continue the work with matching jobs to candidates for various marketplaces, and continue with the work to suggest keywords and the content-based personalization. We're experimenting with a couple of different approaches on how to combine and use both the collaborative filtering and content-based approaches for personalizing news articles, for example. And as I mentioned, more ideas are going to come, and we usually kickstart these projects and work in quads of product, UX, data science, and engineering, put people together, workshop, and sometimes hack ideas so that we come up with some sensible project plan. Good. I kind of went through a whole bunch of highlights. I don't know what level of detail you guys would like, just shoot questions.